This is the Internet of Bugs. My name is Carl, and today I'm going to explain the worst thing about being a software developer in early 2024 and what might be done about it. It's not ChatGPT, and it's not layoffs, although it makes both of those things worse. There's not a pithy one-word phrase for it. I could call it priorities or sentiment, but those are way too vague. The best way I know to explain it is with a quick example. Please stick with me. It'll make sense in a couple of minutes. So this graphic is a timeline of the last 6 or so months. These events all concern Microsoft, but Microsoft is not the problem, and I could have used different companies and timeframes. This example is just the most recent. So we're starting here in July of 2023. Microsoft has to announce that the US government was hacked via Microsoft's Office 365 cloud service. Turns out the hack was because Microsoft lost control of some of its private keys, which is not good. And as a result, the US Senate accuses Microsoft of cybersecurity negligence. In an unrelated incident in September, Microsoft has 38 terabytes of data hacked and stolen, including private keys and passwords, internal messages, all kinds of stuff. Jumping to October, Microsoft has to release a patch for their mail server software product, not their cloud mail product that we had talked about back in July. Different product, different bug. To make matters worse, in this particular case, they're releasing a second fix for an active problem because their initial response didn't solve the problem the first time. The next month, Microsoft's device driver model is found to have a bug that lets hackers get full system control. In December, Russian hackers are exploiting a new Outlook bug to hijack people's email. Now, this is not the bug in their mail server product like we saw in October, and not the cloud product we saw in July. This is a bug in the email client. So this is the third bug involving Microsoft Mail. Microsoft tells their users frantically, please go patch everything, but patching everything really isn't enough. Because a month later, Microsoft's own executives have their company emails hacked. This leads to another accusation of negligence from the government, but it's not just their email products. In January, Microsoft's site was used to generate Taylor Swift porn that went viral on Twitter, and Microsoft has to make a frantic change to fix that site. We're now up to 3 critical exploits in 3 unrelated email products, plus a device driver exploit, an AI exploit that leads to viral deepfake celebrity porn, and 2 government accusations of negligence. And that's just a few months. And I could have added so many more examples. And I'm only talking about security issues because they make headlines and good visuals to show on YouTube. But headlines are prominent. And even people who aren't in the industry should see the headlines, right? There should be consequences for all those problems, right? Well, their punishment was becoming the most valuable company ever. So this is the problem. As long as there are no consequences for negligence, this is going to keep happening. The fundamental truth is, it is awful to be a responsible, ethical human being working as a developer in a world where company executives are rewarded for dereliction with huge stock bonuses that are valued based on hype and not on performance. This causes all kinds of problems. It makes companies like layoffs, because when layoffs result in poorer software quality, nobody cares. It causes companies to want to replace workers with AI bots. Because even if the AI does a much worse job, the managers making the decisions get rewarded by hype-driven stock bonuses and pay no penalties for security and quality going down. And make no mistake, using more AI and fewer experienced programmers to develop software will make quality much worse. I've got a whole series of videos coming up soon on the impact of generative AI to software, so subscribe if you want to see those. Okay, time to take a breath. Now, this hasn't always been true. I've been a software professional for 35 years, and it used to be a lot better. And I believe that we, the technical professionals doing the work, need to talk about this more. If the business and the government people think that this is just the way it has to be, it'll keep staying this way. But when technical professionals push for security and quality long enough and loud enough, we make it better. I've seen it happen. Let me give you a quick example from the long, long ago. Back in the early 1990s, web encryption was legally required to be weak and insecure. We didn't have SSH. Anytime you logged into a system, your password went across in the clear. Buying something online meant your credit card number could be stolen. Online banking was just unthinkable. All the public-facing servers I personally run even now use OpenBSD for an operating system, and I have an OpenBSD shirt on now. Because back when I started putting my own servers online, OpenBSD was the only OS that shipped with decent encryption software, because it was distributed from Canada, and nothing like it was allowed to be distributed that way from inside the US. And speaking of shirts, this is a shirt from that era that was legally considered to be ammunition. These shirts were sold as a fundraiser to educate people. But after years of fundraising, educating the business community, and court challenges, computer professionals managed to get that ruling reversed. And that reversal made the internet so much safer and so much more secure. It enabled so much more e-commerce and created so many technical jobs. So it can be done, although it takes time. It requires people to speak out publicly, to have uncomfortable conversations, and to insist that the status quo isn't acceptable. The status quo is not acceptable. Now, those voices are growing, and I hope they continue to do so. It can get better. We just have to insist that it does. Thanks for watching, and I hope you come back.